the Hobby Time Kept Model Airplane Company. To start this video on Hobby Time, we must go back to 1915 and start with the Western Coil and Electrical Company of Racine, Wisconsin. Founded by William Turner Lewis and his father, the company's original business was manufacturing radios, later called the Radiodyne brand. Sometime in the 1930s, the company decided to produce their first toy, an O-scale version of the Burlington Zephyr Streamliner locomotive. The reason for this unusual expansion to their business has never been completely clear, but it was likely just to cash in on the lucrative toy and model train business, which was booming at the time. It was the only model train they ever made and was labeled the West Wind. It also came with its own proprietary three-rail tubular O-gauge and standard gauge sectional T-track. The Zephyr models were produced from 1934 to 1940. In 1932, Western Coil and Electric stopped making their own radios and began selling rebranded Wells Gardner radios with the Western Coil brand. But they still manufactured electrical devices, TV towers, and many plastic toys. In 1949, they began manufacturing balsa wood model airplane kits, some with plastic accessories under the name Hobby Time. There was a series of six kits that were called solids because they were made of solid wood with some plastic details, but these kits were rapidly falling out of fashion with model builders. This forced Hobby Time to migrate towards fully plastic kits. A classic example of one of their solid wooden kits was their F-89 Scorpion. It was done in typical fashion for the times with a partially pre-shaped fuselage and flying surfaces that you punched out of sheet balsa, and a dowel and blocks for the remainder of the wooden parts. There was also a slightly crude decal sheet and a vacuum-form plastic canopy, and a display stand, and four rubber-like tires. The instructions featured three view drawings and cross-section templates for the fuselage and airfoils, along with color and markings guidance. This kit happens to be a 1:96 scale kit, so it would fit right in with a collection of 1:100 scale models if one wanted to do the huge amount of work required to make it presentable. The other five Hobby Time solid kits were the XB-47, a British Meteor, an F-86, an F-89, and a British de Havilland Venom. These kits did not have particularly impressive box art, but it was typical for the era. All the Hobby Time solid kits were jets, but as mentioned, competition from the likes of Comet and Monogram, which had already switched to all plastic models, forced Hobby Time to follow suit, and by the mid-1950s, they were making plastic kits. The three sets of normal static plastic model kits came in a World War II fighter series that consisted of a P-47 Thunderbolt, a P-51 Mustang, a BF-109, and a Spitfire. A World War II bomber series was also made that consisted of a B-29 Superfortress, a B-24 Liberator, a B-25 Mitchell, and an A-26, but oddly enough, not a B-17. And there was a series of jet fighters that consisted of an F-100A Super Sabre, an F-4D Skyray, an F-84F, and an F-89D Scorpion. These were issued both as individually boxed or bagged kits and in boxed gift sets, but they were not done to a constant scale. However, they were fairly close to 1/72nd scale. The bombers ranged between 1:133 and 1:242 in scale. The paper headers on the bagged kits referred to all jet balsa solids, propeller-type plastic solids, jet-type plastic solids, and plastic flyers. It seems the World War II fighters may have been ex-Lindbergh kits, at least according to the timelines on Scalemates. Box art, decals, assembly diagrams, parts breakdown, all match. And they were both made in a rather unusual 1:64 scale. Hobby Time probably leased the molds for the old odd-scale Lindbergh kits or just bought them already made from Lindbergh. It seems that Lindbergh did do another run of these kits on their own after Hobby Time released their versions, so Lindbergh probably got their molds back. The parts count on the box tops does not quite seem to match what's shown in the instructions. The parts count on the Lindbergh versions is higher than for the Hobby Time versions. Lindbergh may have reduced the parts count at some stage. It looks like the propeller shaft was originally a separate part, but it might have later been made part of the propeller molding. The guns on the P-47 were originally separate units, but were later made part of the wing molding. In the case of the P-47, some hobby time boxes say 24 plastic parts, other 23 plastic parts. Apart from the standard versions molded in silver plastic, there were also special night fighter versions of all four kits, which were molded in black plastic. The bagged versions of these kits look to have the special night fighter cards inside the plastic bag with the instructions printed on the back, but seem to have come in silver plastic. All were originally molded in silver plastic and had one-piece wings, with the undercarriage doors molded closed, but with holes in the wing for the main undercarriage legs. Interior detail consisted of a head for the pilot, and all had a clear canopy as well as a two-piece display stand, which is included in the parts count. The scales were mixed, but all the kits had a 6-inch wingspan. Despite the low parts count and basic detail, both of the U.S. fighters had underwing rocket launchers of the triple bazooka type. The World War II bomber series were all American aircraft, two twin engine and two four engine. The seemingly odd thing is the lack of a B-17, which is kind of the quintessential American bomber, but no B-17 mold was ever made. These kits are also listed on ScaleMates as having been issued by Sunil in France. As far as I can tell, the kits are original to Hobby Time, although the base of the stands is identical in shape to those of the Hobby Time Lindbergh fighter kits. However, the arms are different. There was one outlier kit, which was one of the earlier plastic kits and is probably the most collectible Hobby Time plastic kit of all. This was the Bell XV-3 convertiplane in 1:43 scale, released in 1955. It was issued both in a box, bag, and blister pack. This kit is often confused with the ITC 1:32 scale McDonnell XV-1 convertiplane, which is now released by Glencoe Models. They also had three vacuform flying model kits in approximately 1:48 scale, the Demon, the Sky Ray, and the Super Sabre. The flying versions only list the number of plastic parts, but the solid versions list both the number of plastic parts and decal units. In the case of the F-89 Scorpion, the parts counts are different. There was also a flight pack portrait gift pack with all four fighter kits. A large color picture seems to have been printed directly on the back of the box. There was also a flight portrait gift pack containing all four of the bomber models. The only example we could find online that showed the portrait of a Douglas C-133. A beautiful picture indeed, but has nothing to do with the kits in the box. This was printed directly on the bottom of the box. The box top artwork is basically the same as the fighter set. It's possible these were kits they were planning to make at some point, or perhaps it was just deceptive marketing. Numerically, the flying models were the last kits from Hobby Time. They were the only three types in the series, all modern jets. The Super Sabre and Sky Ray were also included in the smaller scale non-flying jet range. Only the Demon was unique to the flying model range. All are described on the box top as educational airplane kits, all plastic flying model. Given that the F-100A box top describes the model as an Army jet fighter, not Air Force, might make one question the actual educational value. The parts count on the box top just says parts rather than usual plastic parts. The box art shows a pair of aircraft in flight, with the Skyray also throwing in an aircraft carrier. Being flying models, weight was a major concern, and all the kits have their fuselages, wings, and tails and stands made from white vacuform plastic. It appears the undercarriage doors were also vacuform. There is a small sprue of injected molded plastic silver for the details, mostly for the undercarriage and the head of the pilot. It includes a clear canopy and a decal sheet. It appears a small sheet of sandpaper was included, just like in the old wooden kits. The flange around the parts was not to be removed except where the pilot and canopy were to fit. The models could be built as flying models using just the vacuform parts, with the only injection molded parts being the pilot's head and the canopy. Alternatively, they could be built as normal static display models using the injection molded undercarriage parts. The nose wheel fork is once more a separate part in all three kits. The instruction sheet devoted one side to building the model for flight and the other side to build it as a static display model. These kits were made to a larger scale than the non-flying kits, again, about 1 to 48 scale. A three-piece vac form display stand was included. A nameplate for this was printed on the instruction sheet. You could cut this out and affix it to the stand. In flying mode, the models were intended for launching from a catapult, which was included with the kit. This sounds like a violent way to launch a model. Not something I'd want to try after all the hard work of building the kit. The catapult consisted of a green stick, a rubber band, and a triangular piece. It seems this functioned as a nose weight, with the lower section acting as a hook for the rubber band. This was to be sanded smooth to prevent cutting into the rubber band. If the model was to be built for display, the triangular part was to be cut in half, with the front retained as a nose weight, and the rear discarded. Somehow, I doubt they flew very well. Hobby time was late to the game in both balsa and in plastic, ergo it is no surprise that they never became a major player in the kit model industry. They stopped kit production in the late 1960s. The company was gone by the end of 1969. The molds for the static plastic kits wound up in Costa Rica and were re-released in the 1980s under the Plastico Star label, but they too soon folded. So that is the brief story of Hobby Time, a subdivision of a larger company that was never more than a small player in the kit model world, yet managed to hang around for two decades. Did you ever build a Hobby Time kit? What's your opinion? I'm Max of Max's Models. Hope you enjoyed this brief video, and as always, model on. I'm gonna go get some more.